Okay, class. So now let's go on to the next topic from civics chapter 4, gender, religion and caste. So in the last class, we have seen that about communalism, we have seen about casteism, how casteism and politics is there, how communalism and politics are there, how they are creating problems also, and how the constitution is trying to solve it, how the constitution had made rules according to not keeping any type of discrimination related to any type of community, religion or caste. Now here we are going to see about elections. No parliamentary constituency has a clear majority of one single caste. Every candidate or party must win the confidence of more than one caste and community to win the election. There is no parliamentary constituency in our country which is clearly or which has a clear majority of one single caste. People from different castes and different religion and different genders are available in our parliamentary constituency. No party wins the votes of all voters of a caste or community. There is nothing like that. Okay, if he is belonging to a religion, whatever votes he have got, everything is from only a religion. That is also not there. No party wins the votes of all voters of a caste community. Third one, many political parties may put up candidates from same caste. Ruling party, sitting MP, losing election could not have happened if all castes and communities were frozen in political preferences. Ruling party or sitting MP losing election, that could not have happened. Why? If all castes and communities were frozen in political preferences, then how will a proper ruling party or sitting MP be going to lose the election? So, caste is not having anything related to elections. In elections, in our constitution, equal value is given to each and every religion and caste. It's not like that if the candidate is of one religion, then the other people, the common people from that religion can only give vote to him, or we should only take vote from those religions. It's not like that. We are a secular state, so we have to be according to that. We should not give any kind of importance to any religion or caste. What forms does caste take when it is politicized? That means if caste is taken into politics, then what forms can it take? Caste group becomes big by including neighboring castes. Party enters into a coalition with other castes. Rise of backward caste and forward caste group. These are some of the forms which caste can take place. That is, caste group can become big. How? They can include also the other people, other neighbored country caste can also come here. Party can enter into a coalition government with other castes. Rise of backward caste and forward caste group. This can also happen if caste is taking form in politics. Effects of exclusive attention to caste. Now, if we are giving exclusive attention to caste, what will be the effects? It is negative. Politics based on caste identity alone is not healthy. Diverts attention from poverty, development and corruption. Leads to tension, conflict and even violence. That means, if we are giving more attention to caste exclusively, then it is negative for that country. It's not going to do anything good. And the politics based on caste identity is not at all healthy, because there will be always a civil war going on inside the people related to caste and religion. And we don't want such kind of unpeaceful matters or any kind of destructive matters in our country, because we are having lots and lots of other problems like poverty is there, development, corruption. From here, all our attention will get diverted and everyone will focus only on caste and religion. But that's not the aim of a constitution and that's not the aim of a democracy. The main aim of a democratic government and a constitution is to remove poverty from the country, to bring development. to remove corruption, no bribing, nothing. This is the main aim of our constitution and of our democratic government. So if we will give attention to caste and religion, then it is going to, of course, divert our attention from all the other matters which is more important for economic development. This problem can also lead to tension, conflict, and even violence, as I told you. Civil war will take place, of course, because we are giving importance to religion. And when it comes to religion, when it comes to caste, when it comes to community, people will start taking it personally so much. Anybody can kill anybody at any point of time. Okay, you are not of our religion, you should not live in this country. This can also happen. So it should not be there. It can create tensions, it can create conflict. And violence can take place, which is not at all healthy for an purpose or economic development of the country, not even for the public living in that same country. Now, popular struggles and movements. Nepal. Now, first we are going to see about Nepal. Nepal has won democracy in 1990. The former power was with the king. And the real parts was with elected representatives. As they got their democracy, they started getting elected representatives. Elections were there. In 2001, massacre of royal family, Ganendra took charge. 2005, dissolution of parliament happened. 2006, popular control over government headed by the king. Seven-party alliance called for a four-day strike. Maoists and other organizations joined. 21st April, the king conceded to all demands leading to restoration of parliament, seizure of power from the ruler to make Korela prime minister. Maoists and CPAs came to an agreement about a new constituent assembly to be elected. After getting the elected representatives, after forming a government, everything got dissolved again. Again, the parts went to the hands of kings. But then there were problems which created a lot of issues there in Nepal. And again in 21st April, again the king gave everything back. The restoration of parliament was done. The power was taken from the ruler and given to the government. Prime Minister was appointed, presidents were appointed, elected representatives were given power, and also the Maoists and other parties, they came into an agreement that a new constituent assembly has to be elected. It should be having a proper rules and regulations. Now again, we don't want any kind of monarchy or we don't want any kind of military power going on in Nepal, and at last they made a new constituent assembly to be elected for Nepal. And now the case of Bolivia. Fight against privatization of water. World Bank pressurized government to give up control of municipal water supply. Sale of rights to a MNC for the city of Cochabamba. Company raised the price of water 4 times. 4-day general strike by labor and human rights and community leaders. Government agreed to negotiate. Power of the people forced MNC to flee and made government to concede to all demands. And water supply was restored to municipality at old rates. Now what happened? The thing is, there was fight against the privatization of water. Water supply, all the things were given to private sectors. Now, what is the main agenda of private sectors is to earn profit, right? So now what is going to happen? They are, of course, going to raise the price of water. So what happened, the real case was the World Bank, they pressurized the government of Bolivia to give up the control of municipal water supply. And the sale of rights of water was given to a MNC. Now what the company did, the multinational company, they raised the price of water 4 times. And as a human being or as a living being, water is very much essential for us. And if we are going to pay this much high price for water, then how can common people, how can poor people live? Right? So there was 4 days general strike which took place by the laborers, human rights and community leaders. And at last, the government agreed to negotiate after seeing all the strikes and problems. Then, the power of people, how did they show their power? How the people showed their powers by strike? And they forced the MNC to go away. And again, the government got the power of controlling the water supply. The water supply was restored in the hands of municipality at the old rate. And this was the case. This was the struggle and movement which took place in Bolivia related to privatization of water. Some of the similarities in Nepal and Bolivia. Involvement of mass mobilization was there. Public demonstration of mass support clinched the dispute. Involvement of political organizations. Instances of political conflict that led to a popular struggle. These were the similarities which was seen in Nepal and Bolivia, that how the people have taken the things into consideration and how with the help of popular struggles and movements they brought back the things properly right. The political conflicts were removed. There were involvement of political organizations in the problem. There was involvement of mass mobilization. So these are some of the similarities which are seen in popular struggle and movement in Nepal and Bolivia. Now, what are the differences that happened in Nepal and Bolivia? Earlier, we have seen the similarities. Now, what are the differences? In Nepal, what was they trying to do? They were trying to establish democracy. In Bolivia, claims on an elected government. That means government was already there. But only on one thing they were having problem, that was privatization of water. So the claims on an elected government. In Nepal, foundation of country's politics. Bolivia, one specific policy of privatization of water. Next, SPA had some big parties with MPs. FEDOKAR composed of professional engineers and environmentalists. Here, as in Nepal, they were having the problem of parties, they were having the problem of democracy, politics and all. So, there were MPs also in this. The members of parliament were also included. Here in FEDOKAR, they were composed of all type of professionals, were there engineers, were there environmentalists, were there who were looking after the issue of privatization of water. In Nepal, Maoists did not believe in parliamentary democracy. Involved themselves in armed struggle, thereby establishing control over large parts. They were joined by labor unions, organization of indigenous people, teachers, lawyers, and human rights groups. Maoist people were there, they did not believe in parliamentary democracy. So, which type of democracy they wanted is, they wanted a type of direct democracy in them where everyone together will take the decision. So they were also involved in armed struggle and they tried to control the large parts of Nepal, and they also were joined by labor unions and other people in their group. Here in Bolivia, it was Federation of Farmers, Confederation of Factory Workers Unions, middle class students from University of Cochabamba and the city's growing population of homeless street children. Socialist Party supported this. Here, Social Party supported this because here mostly everything was related to the people who were in maximum use of water. The things what was happening in Cochabamba was not at all good because water paying price for it, 4 times bigger, it was not possible for a middle class or poor class family to afford this much costly water. Two-way roles of these organizations are direct participation in competitive politics, creation of parties contesting elections and forming the government. The two-way roles of these organizations are, what are they? They direct participation in the competitive politics. Directly they were participating in the competitive politics and they were also creating parties that could contest in the election and form a proper government. These were the two-way roles of the organizations. Now, from formations of organizations, how the organizations were formed. From here, we will be seeing in the next slide. Thank you.